and Vice President Scotty with the consent agenda.
Yes.
We have item number one, ordinance number 24-200. That paper is continued to Monday, February 14th.
Any questions on this paper?
Item number two, ordinance number 2012-209, to amend the city code concerning unlawful nuisances for the purpose of declaring certain unsanitary or unsafe conditions to be nuisances and prohibiting persons who own and occupy property from allowing such nuisances to exist on such property.
Any questions, Mr. Rule?
Yes, just curious to know if there's someone who can explain, this has to do with inside of the premises. Can someone explain what triggers such an inspection for one to go inside of the premises? Is it complaint driven or?
Board item, Department of Health and Review, Property Maintenance Code Enforcement Division. It could be complaint driven. If you're variety of mechanisms, it could come to our request for assistance.
Hold on, I'll test a little bit, sir, so we can give you a little bit of.
It could be complaint driven. It could be the tenant that calls or within a multi-family unit that has a problem. It could be a private homeowner that just wants assistance, has a problem, doesn't know how to solve it. So that could be one way.
And do we have clear-cut criteria as to what constitutes a violation?
It would depend on the type of vermin or pests we're dealing with. There's also other provisions in there, such as the hazardous tree provision.
Hazardous?
There's a hazardous tree provision?
Yes.
In the nuisance. So, let's say, for example, the buzzword seems to be veterans nowadays. And the criteria would be that you had visible bed bugs, or you had the droppings of bed bugs, or you had evidence of bites of bed bugs, some sort of physical evidence that there was an infestation.
Well, what I'm concerned about is neighbors who want to reach out and attack other neighbors who make complaints of this nature,
right,
for purely meanness purposes. I'm just trying to make sure that there's some safeguards.
That's the nature of the complaint-driven business that we often do in code enforcement. If you complain, the neighbor has trash in the backyard, the neighbor has tall grass, and we don't know until we want to take a look. Those kind of motives can't occur.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks.
Any other questions? What's the penalty? And would the nuisance be limited to just the ones that identify in the ordinance?
It indicates rats, mice, bed bugs, fleas, mosquitoes, all other pests, infestations. Mm-hmm. Primarily be limited to those what we call vectors. Vectors are any animal or insect that carry a disease on the animal. Also flies, I believe, and also. That comes in companionship too with some of the trash and garbage plants we take. We have a trash problem. You can see a rat hanging around. There's no provision for us to address that issue.
So my second part of the question is, what is the penalty if the person is found to be in violation of this ordinance?
It would be the same as the other environmental violations in that code section, which are a suspension.
Mr. Weaver.
Same as tall grass, same as garbage and trash, same as an outdoor vehicle.
So there's a takings court?
They could be.
You would issue a citation and give them a reasonable time to make complaints?
Exactly. The same as the trash and tall grass. And those violation may be issued a reasonable time given for compliance and the expectation of compliance to be made. And the option of either going to court or having some do the work and put a it would be the person from whom caused the condition. For example, if you have a single-family dwelling that was being rented, but the problem was, say, for cockroaches, and due to the uncleanliness, and the housekeeping habits of the tenant, then that person would be responsible.
Thank you. I don't understand that, because if you have rental property and you're, you know, you put renters in there and you go on a lease with them, the left of them, if you got beer cans out on your porch, that's going to cause roaches. Together, that tenant will call code enforcement and report the landlord because she's got roaches. You know, that's not fair. When a person moved in a home, it was spotless, clean, and everything else, because they got beer cans or they got this piled all off at the porch because they're collecting them. Then they get bugs or they get rats, and then they want to turn the person in that owns the property. I think that the person that is renting the property should be held accountable for it, especially when the landlord goes in and says, you've got to cut this grass because, you know, they don't want to get another notice or something like that, the grass needs to be cut. You get to the land, the person that owns the property is the one that gets the, you know, the letter.
I agree. What I just indicated was the person responsible who created the condition. So if the condition is caused by poor housekeeping habits, beer cans, trash, garbage, not doing the dishes for several days in a row, you see them all up in the sink, the tenant would be responsible for that, not the landlord.
Okay, and then I know there are some landlords that own a lot of properties that you can't find, you can't get in touch with them, and then, you know, the neighbors will call in the council people to report because the renters said they're not doing this or not doing that. And it looks like the city doesn't come down on those, per se, landlords, because they can't find them or whatever. So that's how I was wondering, would you go after those renters when you can't find the landlords that own the properties?
A couple of cases. One where the landlord is out of state, you're right. You can't send sums across the state line for a misdemeanor. However, in the case of an infestation, it's a case-by-case basis. Usually people are calling us because they have a problem. I say us, I mean, I enforce proper maintenance in Fairfax County for 31 years with the health department. And most of the times people are calling, they have a problem, and they want how to do it, how to be educated. So we educate rather than regulate. If we go out to a tenant that has, say, a rat problem in the backyard, or he sees a rat swimming on his neighbor's yard into his yard, generally would allow place flyers, notices. Here's the things that you can do to clean up your property. Here's the things you can do to control the road problem. Generally, it's an educated approach up front. After that, we have something when you come back, you see neighbors that have cleaned up their trash, have picked up the litter in the yard, but one neighbor hasn't, then that's the only probably indication of those to tell them, you have to do this.
You're going to get a lot of calls about Section 8.
Or apartments.
Or single-family homes where there's 15 people living in a Section 8 home that are throwing out the beer cans and dirty jumpers and stuff like that.
Well, I can tell you from experience that infestations, we don't want to use the social economic class that handle many, many rat calls in the claim that they don't need our homes because the dog food and emergency are outside. So it's kind of an equal opportunity event having pests sometimes.
Okay, so this law is applied to everybody then, right?
Yeah, and usually it is, again, it's education. People say, I've got a problem, I never had, say, rats before, and I'm seeing them in the yard, what can I do? And we can go out there and do more than a general pest control operator can do, because we can go from neighbor to neighbor, and we can canvas the neighbor, and beat up lives, and say, there's nothing you can do. Because the rodents are going to be on one property, if we're running another property, the food and then back over to the other end. So I think by a comprehensive approach, then we get some sort of sense of control.
Thank you.
And Mr. Jewell?
One last question. The situations in which there is a decrepit tree, a tree that's split, that clearly is going to continue to split as time goes on, falls over into a neighbor's property, or falls on their own property, or falls over into the right of way. Is a tree that is threatening a part of this ordinance?
Yes, in this particular ordinance, there's a hazardous tree provision, and it states that trees in danger of falling onto the property, into a home, into a street, onto a vehicle, onto the right-of-way. We can address that tree before it falls. Now, what we currently have is only the ability to tell a person to remove the tree after it's fallen. Many other jurisdictions, including where I came from, have this hazardous tree provision, it's proactive, and we attempt it before the damage occurs.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. I think that certainly this is something that we have lots of complaints about. It'll be interesting to see how successful it is and how it passed, and maybe after 6 months, maybe come back and tell us how many inspections, how many conditions have been addressed and corrected, as well as this cost as well as additional staffing time to be responsive to those.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Madam President.
I'm sorry.
Yes, thank you. Just had one other quick question, and that is, there was reference in the last thing you indicated that there are other jurisdictions where you work. Are those jurisdictions located within Virginia?
Yeah, Fairfax County. Because they're really owners.
Right. Thank you.
And they have what's called health and safety management, which just was copied heavily off of.
Yes, item number 3, ordinance number 2012-210, to authorize the CAO to accept $39,960 from the Institute of Museum and Library Services and to appropriate increase to fiscal year 2012-13 special fund budget for the library for the purpose of providing summer programs to reduce summer learning loss.
Any questions on this paper?
Item number 4, ordinance number 2012-211, that paper is continued until Monday, January 14th.
Thanks.
Item number 5, ordinance number 2012-212, to erect always stop signs and overweight flashing red lights at the intersection of North Nansen Street on Kensington Avenue to replace the existing traffic regulations at that intersection.
Mr. Powell.
Madam Vice President. It has come to my attention that the fire department did not get notice or